Now we will hear Shri S Gurumurthy, the eminent thought leader, editor Tughlaq, the distinguished chair professor for legal anthropology at Sastra University, chairman of the Vivekananda International Foundation, New Delhi, a true teacher to many of us, to offer his felicitations.
With namaskarams to Parasaran, it's really difficult to felicitate him because I don't belong to the profession of lawyers. At best, I am a trespasser into law. I know all the lawyers, but it doesn't mean I know the law. But I certainly made the lawyers argue in the way I wanted them argue. And one of the earliest cases where I came in contact with Mr. Parasaran was when Mrs. Gandhi ordered the demolition of the Indian Express building in the year 1980, as soon as she came to power. So I was appearing for the, I was assisting the lawyers who were appearing for the Indian Express, and Mr. Parasaran was the Solicitor General appearing for the government. See, what moved me, what I felt was a quality that is needed for a lawyer, particularly a lawyer appearing for the government, is the sense of justice he had, even when he was appearing as a lawyer, because the court wanted his view on whether the move made by the government is fair or not. You know, that's a very difficult thing because it was a political case and the Prime Minister's name is involved, and we have made the Prime Minister as the prime mover because the Indian Express carried on such a powerful campaign against the Prime Minister that it became more or less the initiative of the Prime Minister to get the Indian Express closed down and the building demolished. And Mr. Parasaran was representing not just the government, but the Prime Minister's name was involved in it. But Mr. Parasaran said, yes, I will have consultations with the government. He went back to the government and advised the government not to enforce the notices they had issued against the government. I don't think any other person in that position against such a powerful Prime Minister would have had the courage to give the advice, Madam Prime Minister, please withdraw the Shokas notices you had issued to the Government of India, to the Indian Express on behalf of the Government of India. The government wouldn't listen. Not that the government always listens to vice counsel, and the government didn't listen. You know what happened? Mr. Parasaran came and told the judges, I am not going to represent the government hereafter. No one knew he had tendered this advice to the government, and the government had not listened to it because he didn't want to put the government in difficulty. At the same time, his conscience was clear that he had acted with the sense of justice which his profession, the true profession as a lawyer, called upon him to do. And in fact, Nariman was appearing on the other side, and all of us wanted to know why the Solicitor General is not going to appear, because we wanted to expose the government. Parasaran stood to his ground. He was sincere, but he did not betray the government by saying that the government did not accept his advice. Then I saw how people of wisdom behave, that they clear their conscience and do not put anybody in difficulty, and that is how the government of the day was saved. Otherwise, the government would have been in serious difficulty at that time. So Mr. Parasaran always used to praise me extraordinarily, to encourage me. And it's 39 years of my experience with him, opposing him most of the time in many cases. And the last case in which I briefed him was a case on behalf of the TVS group. In fact, I was trying to brief him on the engineering aspect of a particular innovation. He said, I feel that you should be in my position to argue this case, and I am not able to understand. He was able to understand everything, but the humility with which he was willing to hear what I was saying, the most important quality that I saw in him from 1980 to, this was sometime in 2007 or 8, consistently one quality which I saw in him was his outstanding humility, which in most of the senior counsels we will not be able to see today. So that is the greatest tribute I can give to him. There is a concept called Nabhuto Nabhavishyati. That such a thing never existed, nor is it going to exist. It applies to a senior counsel like Parasaran, because it is not only the overall comprehensive, overarching knowledge he had on subjects which are interrelated, which are interconnected, but the way he put it to the court, apart from law, of course, they had mentioned these two grand cases, the Shabarimala case and the Ram Janmabhoomi cases. These are not cases. They are paradigm shifting of the Indian legal and judicial course. It's not that any other counsel would have been able to present it as well in law. But I don't think anyone could have presented it from the perspective of the Indian tradition, culture, value systems, and what this country is, the soul of the country cannot be presented in the way in which Parasaran did. You know, this is not something for which you can get a counsel for a fee. These are all not cases which can be handled for a fee. This requires a higher commitment. And that's how the Ram Janmabhoomi case, with which I had very intense association as someone who has been part of the movement itself, when he argued this case and won the case. You know, in our house there was a celebration. We all cried. My wife, who will normally not come to these proceedings, she said, I wanted to come and do Sashtanga Namaskaram for Parasaran. And she did it. And she said, you must find an occasion where I will be able to do Namaskaram for him. Fortunately, when we came, he was also coming, and she did Sashtanga Namaskar. Whether she is interested in the speech or not, it is irrelevant. But that is the extent to which this case touched the hearth and homes of the people of India. When I went to Ayodhya in 1983, I could not sleep for 3 days. That was the spectacle. In fact, when Vaidyanathan said that he went there and saw, and he became so emotional. Because it is not a specter which we can digest. If you go to Kashi, you cannot sleep for 2 days. You know, this is not something which is to be ignored. I will tell you, one of the greatest historians, Arnold Toynbee, what he said about Ayodhya, Mathura and Kashi. He had nothing to do with India. He had nothing to do with our traditions or value systems. He was purely a historian. And he delivered a lecture, Maulana Azad Memorial Lecture, by the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan in the year 1963. And he specifically mentioned these three places of importance, religious and spiritual importance for India and Hindus: Kashi, Mathura and Ayodhya. And he mentioned that something happened in Poland in the year 1914 and 15. He recalled it and said what would happen in India. He warned at that time. As I have been speaking, some vivid visual memories have been flashing up in mind's eye. One of these is the picture of the principal square in Polish city of Warsaw, sometime late in 1920s. In the course of the first Russian occupation of Warsaw, 1914-15, the Russians had built Eastern Orthodox Christian Cathedral on the central point in the city that had been the capital of once important Roman Catholic Christian country, Poland. When Russia occupied, Russia built a Russian Orthodox church in a central place in Poland. The Russian had done this to give the Poles a continuous ocular demonstrations The Russians were their masters. This is the most important thing you have to see between what is political and what is religious. Both are Christians. Both are cathedral. After the establishment of Poland's independence in 1918, the Poles pulled down the cathedral. The demolition had been completed just before the date of my visit, that is, Toynbee's visit. I do not greatly blame the Polish government for having pulled down. It was pulled down by the government. And you know, for 3 days this demolition took place, and it was widely broadcast over the radio. The purpose for which the Russians had built it has been not religious but political, and the purpose had been intentionally offensive. Then he comes to India. Aurangzeb's building these three mosques, Ayodhya, Kashi and Mathura, was the same intentionally offensive political purpose that moved the Russians to build the Orthodox cathedral in the city at Warsaw. Those mosques were intended to signify that an Islamic government was reigning supreme over Hinduism's holiest of holy places. I must say that Aurangzeb had a veritable genius of picking out provocative sites. They are incarnations of a gloomily fanatical vein in the Christian, Muslim, Jewish family of religions. Aurangzeb, a poor, wretched, misguided man, spent a lifetime in doing provocative acts. This was 1963. This was a lecture delivered in India, Azad Memorial Lecture, by the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. You know, this lecture was completely taken out of all the books. Whether I don't know even whether Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan has this today. So this has been a case which the constitutional process of India tried to bury. Let us accept, in the name of secularism, in the name of amity between Hindus and Muslims, this case, this entire idea of these three important places of worship was sought to be buried. See how beautifully Somnath was handled. Somnath temple was constructed as soon as India became free, and by a cabinet resolution, the cabinet of the government of India passed a resolution that Somnath temple should be built. The only condition Mahatma Gandhi laid was that there should be no government contribution to it. It should all be built by private contribution. A person of wisdom, Sardar Patel, accomplished it. Imagine these three places of worship had been dealt with like this. There would have been a Hindu-Muslim problem at all. Was there a Hindu-Muslim problem in Somnath? The Hindu-Muslim problem was created by the secular parties, secular intellectuals, left intellectuals. I will give you the proof of it. You know, in the year 1989, I was very intensely associated with the process of the political parties coming together to defeat Rajiv Gandhi at that time, because the Indian Express was at the core of this whole process. So when we all were working against Rajiv Gandhi, the country was divided into mandal politics and mandir politics. Ramjan Bhumi had risen up, and V.P. Singh had brought in the mandal process to check the Ramjan Bhumi, and Rajiv Gandhi did not know whether to go through the mandal way or the mandir way. This was the position. So when the matters came to the head and Advani went on a Rathayatra for support of the Ram temple construction, I was involved in the negotiation between the BJP, Vishwendu Parishad, RSS and the government. And we brought a formula, and that formula actually worked. Even now what is working is that formula, in which we suggested that a law should be passed to acquire that place, the disputed place in Ayodhya. And the dispute should be referred to the Supreme Court for an opinion whether there was a masjid or a mandir. If it is a masjid, don't touch it. If it is a mandir, the Muslims should hand it over, or the government should acquire that place and give it. This, at 12 o'clock in the night, R. Venkatraman was woken up as the President of India, and this ordinance was passed so that Advani could suspend the Rathayatra and the government could be saved, and the country would be freed from this kind of Hindu-Muslim divide which was developing a big way at that time. But at 4 o'clock in the morning, Mulayam Singh went and woke up V.P. Singh and said, if you are going to do it, I will revolt against you. 4:30 in the morning, the ordinance was withdrawn. That is how it became a major flare-up between Hindus and Muslims. And in 1990, one of the most practical prime ministers of India, who ruled only for 4 months this country, he called the Muslims and the Hindus to have a discussion. He was the most practical person. When Muslims demanded, what is the proof that a temple existed at that place? Chandrasekhar asked them, you are asking for proof in case of Ayodhya. The proof is naked in the case of Kashi and Mathura. Be careful. Don't ask for proof. I advise you to give up this place. This was an advice that the man gave. And the Muslims were very keen to do it. At that time in 1975-76, Bibi Lal's excavation had proved that there was a temple standing right under the mosque. In fact, I don't know whether Nagaswamy is here or not. He said, we will be able to build the Ram temple from the ruins and the broken pieces of the temples which are down under. We will be able to rebuild the temple which existed 1100 years back. This temple, whether it was demolished or not, the mosque was built over it, was a proven situation. K.K. Mohammed, a person of high repute as an archaeologist, he wrote a book saying that I was part of the investigation. There was a temple under it. In 1990, the Muslim community had agreed to accept this position and leave the place. But the secular historian stepped in and said, where is the proof that Rama was born there? Don't be foolish to hand over this place to the Hindus. And that is how this problem was revived. It was not a Hindu-Muslim problem. It is secular left historians opposing the Hindu viewpoint in this country, which will continue, in which the Muslims will become the pawn, an emotional community which already has an aggressive ideology to deal with. You have to only provoke them. This is what has been happening in this country. And this case came to the Supreme Court as not just a legal case or a constitutional case. It came as a political bomb. We must congratulate the Supreme Court. And when we are congratulating the Supreme Court, we must do Sashtanga Namaskaram to Mr. Parasaran. For the simple reason, this judgment was not only an outstanding judgment, as I said, Nabhuto Nabhavishyati, there is not going to be a judgment of this kind in future, nor was there such a judgment. It was a politico-legal judgment. Nobody's emotions were hurt in this judgment. Such a powerfully contradicting religious, secular, legal, constitutional argument with a provocative lawyer opposing Mr. Parasaran on the other side. But the way the case was argued for 40 days, and ultimately the Supreme Court came out with a unanimous decision for which we congratulate the Supreme Court and feel obliged to the Supreme Court for having settled it in a manner unprecedented in the history of the world. If it had been 4-1 verdict, it would not have had the kind of credibility it has had today. A 5-0 judgment, everybody agreeing on the same. Nobody's name is there as the person who wrote the judgment. It was such an impersonal judgment. Unprecedented in the history of the Supreme Court, there has never been a judgment which did not bear the name of a judge who wrote the judgment. Every word was owned by every one of the 5 judges. Even that was not acceptable to some of the mischief makers in this country who want to keep the pot boiling. And I am very happy that the matter has come to such a fine close, a comprehensive close, which no mischief maker will be able to disturb. And when I am standing before all of you, I want to plead with Mr. Parasaran, his homecoming should not mean that he should not go and argue the Sabarimala case. Sabarimala case is more or less the review has been ordered because the religious issues of other religions have been clubbed with this, that is the safety for Hindus. In this country, it has been settled, you can never interfere with minority religious rights. So our religious rights have been treated on par with minority religious rights for the first time in the Sabarimala review case. And I will be happy if Mr. Parasaran goes and argues and completes. And certainly his father has lived up to 99. He will certainly cross 100. So he will have the energy, he will have the memory, he will have the support. And he will have the blessings of the Lord himself to complete his venture. Thank you very much.